What's up, everybody? What's up? Welcome to another episode of the Keynote Cafe. Hey, with your host, LaVelle Powell. Today's guest is none other than chart-topping, award-winning artist, superstar, MAYSA. MAYSA is our guest today on the show. MAYSA got her start. Her rise to prominence began with her being a member of the world-famous Morgan State University Choir. From there, she became a member of Stevie Wonder's all-female backup group, Wonder Love, and which from there led to her getting even more notoriety as a member of Incognito. Hey, British band Incognito. And from there, she's had several solo projects, greatly successful projects to her credit. Hey, so our next guest is MAYSA. Coming right up. So right before we interview the multi-talented MAYSA, who has so many different things going on right now and that you guys will be very interested in knowing about, we're going to start off with one of her hit songs, a 1993 hit when she was with the band Incognito called Deep Waters. We're going to play that one. And then right after that, we're going to go right straight into the interview with the fabulous MAYSA.
Drowning in deep waters, slowly drowning in.
Mesa, thank you very much for coming on the show. I appreciate you coming onto the show.
Thank you, honey. Thank you so much.
All right, it's a pleasure to have you here. So, you know, I have my wife, myself, and some other people who I know are huge fans of yours.
Oh.
They've followed your career extensively, you know, so they were very excited to hear that I was going to be interviewing you, and they're looking forward to watching this one.
That's real good.
Yeah. I wanted to ask you first, you, without a doubt, are one of the most versatile performers in this industry. Yeah. You have a very, I would say, soft, but yet commanding vocal presence, right? You know, and your voice clearly crosses more than one genre, you know, and I was just wondering, so when you sing, do you do so with the intent of identifying with a particular genre, or do you just sing as you're inspired to sing?
I do it as I'm inspired to. Okay. Unless I'm specifically hired for to do like a straight ahead jazz or piece or you know, a country song or whatever, I can kind of tailor it to that specific genre if I have to. But in general, my inspiration, you know, the way I'm inspired to make music and to interpret songs is usually just a spiritual thing. And so I kind of interpret it when I hear the music and the melody and the lyric, you know, the lyrics and stuff, then that kind of determines where I take the song.
Okay. All right. That's great to know. I think that a lot of people, and people have different things that serves as a drive for them as to when they do what they do. And it's always good to hear the different motivations behind various artists' performances. You know, I think that's great to hear. So as far as your own personal influences, were there any past and present people who have served as influences to you to become an artist?
Well, you know, my mother was probably the first person. Like, I heard her sing around the house a lot when I was little. But then when I was 6 years old, she took me to see Pearlie. And when Melba Moore came out on stage and all the lights and the costumes and the dancing and the music, and when she opened up her mouth and sang, my heart, like, I mean, I was only six, but my heart was feeling like it was overwhelmed. And I just knew at that moment that I wanted to make other people feel how she made me feel. And even at a young age of that, I figured that out that early because it was so overpowering and so beautiful. And so she was definitely one of my first influences. And then as I got older, my Uncle Caleb called me one day because I was listening and kind of emulating a lot of pop music at the time.
Yeah.
So he was like, Mason, turn on the PBS. I want you to listen to this. He's a big jazz, you know, big music head, especially jazz though. So I turned it on and Al Jarreau was on. And Al Jarreau was, you know, surrounded by his band. It was like on some kind of circular stage, and he was surrounded by his band. And when he was scatting, he was like an instrument in the band.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh my gosh, like I really want to do this. So I kind of moved me towards that. And then I started listening to Ella Fitzgerald. I started listening to Sarah Vaughan. And so those two, especially Sarah Vaughan. Sarah Vaughan is probably my biggest jazz influence as far as jazz music is concerned. And also Billie Holiday. So when those three singers really got me through my kind of teenage to when I got to Morgan State University and all that stuff. So they kind of drove me in that direction from that point. I've always been R&B, jazz, and all that kind of stuff. But then when I got to college, I got into jazz funk.
Okay.
And that's where I really started feeling okay, this is what I want to do, because it makes the jazz, the scatting, and the R&B and all that together. Yep. And it could be dance music, it could be, you know, so with all those put together, then that's kind of where I've lived my whole life. That's where I am.
That's great, man. And so you've had sort of a melting pot of influences and from various genres and styles and they all tapped into that part of you. Even as a child, when something connects with you, you know, when something like connects with your spirit, it's like, whoa, wait a minute, what is this? You know,
right?
And then you end up over time, you come to realize that this is like my purpose, kind of awakening here inside of me, you know. And it's great that you speak about the different genres, because I think that in order for an artist to really feel comfortable with what they do, they can't allow themselves to be restricted to a single genre. I don't even think they can necessarily even look at genre per se. Just do what comes naturally to you, whatever it is.
Right, because what people don't understand is a direct connection from God to God. So when God puts that into you, that's why, you know, my biggest thing about people ask me advice for younger artists coming up. And I was like, you got to develop that, you know. And I'm not saying some people don't believe in God, so that's on them. I'm not talking to them. I'm talking to people who believe in God. Mm-hmm. And so if you believe in God, then you have to understand that this is a gift you've been given. Mm-hmm. Some people want to use it to exploit themselves unnecessarily. Yeah. But the main thing is that once you realize that this is a connection to God, then it's a whole different life. It's a whole different purpose. Mm-hmm. And that's what I feel like. The purpose I have with my music is to make people feel better, make people feel good, help them through the hard times, help them through the good times. You know, it's just, and that's what it should be about. That's what it should be about.
I'm a big believer in keeping God in it. And one of the things that I've always said is God is the captain of my ship. And I let him navigate and steer the ship the way he wanted to go, because he already knows the destination he has in mind. And in the end, if you let him kind of lead it, then your career will be more fulfilling than it would have been you trying to do it yourself. You know, let him guide it, you know, just follow his lead, you know. So I think that's great advice. And as you said, those who have ear to hear, it's for you. If it's not for you, you know, it doesn't apply to you. But no harm intended. But this is meant for those for whom it applies. You know, so that's excellent advice. Excellent advice. So one of the first occasions that I had when I was introduced to you was when you were with Incognito, in Bluey and all the rest of the great.
Band,
you know, and. I, by the way, the Positivity, that project, I love that. Wow. I regard it as one of my favorites, you know. I guess my question is, what was it like for you working with Incognito, and what personal goals from that experience helped shape your own solo career?
Wow. Working with Incognito is a absolute dream come true. It was for Bluey to choose me to lead his band vocally over the phone, which was amazing. That was the magical. Yeah. But then to move to London and grow into that culture, grow into, you know, the British kind of life, and then also touring, because, you know, I was just like, I was brand new at that, you know. I was 24 years old, and so I was kind of thrown into the fire, so to speak, just on stage. And there's circulating now this this old video of me lip syncing for a TV show. I was lip syncing Jocelyn Brown, Always There, and then another song, and so, you know, Crazy for You, I think. And so, you know, at the beginning, because, you know, I just joined the band, so that was in January of 1992.
Okay.
And so I had just joined the band in December 1991, so that was one of the first things I had to do. I had to learn those songs, and lip sync them for it because they had a television show. They had to do this television show. And I was kind of like, okay, come on, Mason, you're part of the band. Now, like, do this first. And then I was able to develop with the music with Charles Robinson Scribes, Can We Change the World? Changes. And then I Love What You Do For Me.
Okay.
For the first album. So then I started developing my own sound with the band.
Okay.
So it was all a learning experience. Like, I went from Morgan State University to another university. I went straight into a whole nother, learning experience. So it was great. The musicians, the guys in the band were great. They treated me like little sister and they were very protective and very sweet and very just nice to me. Everybody was just cool. And, I used to fry chicken for them and take on a tour bus. And I would fry chicken and cornbread and put it in a basket and take it on the tour bus. So I showed them love in that way too. So it was an amazing experience. One of my first grown up, major love affairs happened, wow. In the band with my son's father, the percussionist in the band. And so it was an all around amazing experience. So what I learned from being in Incognito is that I learned from Blue, I learned about leadership. I learned about how to lead a band, how to deal with business, how to do interviews, how to, everything that prepared me for my solo career, I learned by being Incognito, definitely.
Okay, that's awesome, man. That's like all that journey that you took on. And it sounds like some very key components sort of came together during that experience.
Yeah, it did. Awesome. That's a really, God's way he connects stuff is amazing. It was a lot of touring, a lot of, cities, I've been around the world. Blue has taken me around the world, I don't know how many times. It's been absolutely amazing.
That's why it's so important to let him lead it, let him be the lead, because he'll mm-hmm. take you places you never even imagined you'd be going.
Right. Right.
So your first solo project was a self-titled, entitled Mesa. So with that, was there any pressure or what was it like, I guess, preparing for that project?
And that was another magic carpet ride again. Wow. I was at the North Sea Jazz Festival in with Incognito. We were in front of an audience, they called it in the JVC room, they called it. And the audience was 18,000 people, 15 to 18,000 people. It was crazy. And so at the end of it, I was walking off stage and this man walks up to me, he says, my name is Carl Griffin from GRP Records. Are you ready for your solo career?
All right.
And that's just how it happened, just like that. And so when he got back to the States, and I got back to London, he called me and he said, this is real. I had to check him out, make sure it was real. Yeah. And of course it's a real deal. And I went to New York shortly after and signed my first solo deal. Okay. So, and then from there, it was just all magical. I mean, the first album, we did strings at Abbey Road, it was just amazing how, it was a 60 piece string section. It was unbelievable. It cost me a lot of money. I still haven't paid that money back yet. But the first album was pure magic. And I think that's probably why it's still today one of my, my most well-received albums in my career, because it really had a magic and a blessing on it.
Street. She looked worn and tired.
See, another thing I love about talking to artists like yourself is I get an opportunity to see and hear the excitement in your voice, right? And on your face when you're talking about aspects of your career and your journeys and, and milestones reached and stuff like that. And, you know, I love to see that because, you know, I went through that myself. I just think it's just a beautiful thing to see. And that's one of the things that I love about the show, because as an admirer of the art in general, it's just such a wonderful experience to see other people's excitement about big career achievements that they that they've made, you know. So I just think that's one of us. I just had to add that in there.
Thank you, babe.
So with that, what do you attribute to your longevity and your success in this industry?
Going back to God, of course, all the time. God first. Mm-hmm. I've had my parents and my family my parents are gone, but my family has been in general very supportive of me through the whole process. I think having people who just support everything I do. My friends, friends included. My friends are my family, so. Yeah. You know, including they were there with me. They go through stuff. They travel with me. They, you know, support me in many ways. So that was, I think that's helped. Also, my work ethic that I learned from my parents is very strong. I try to be very professional much as I can. Even I'm a bit overwhelmed sometimes with, because I kind of do everything myself. Okay. So I get a little overwhelmed. It takes me a little bit longer to do things. But I think for the most part, I give, I try to give 150%. To whatever I do, and if, especially in my music, especially in the touring, I want to give the promoters and the audience way more than what they pay for. You know, I just want them to feel like it was worth the money that they spent, they sacrificed out of their money, you know, to give to me to perform for them. So it's very important that people are happy with my performance.
Is that very important? That says a lot about you know, your level of commitment and dedication to your craft. Because I mean, there are those who may not appear to devote the kind of commitment that people like yourself and others apply. You know, I think it's very important, and it in the end, those things serve to continue your career, to make it even more, make it last longer and more fulfilled, and you get more appreciation yourself and your fans and your supporters. They appreciate you more because they see that. They actually will see that. Whoa, I can tell that whoa, she put her heart and soul in it. You know, they just know they love it. They may not know like the amount of effort you put into it, but they can tell that whoa, that end product. It's like wow, you know.
Yeah, I try.
That's what
trying to give my best. Absolutely trying to give my best and you know, I want to leave a legacy for my son. Like, I want him to do the same. I want him to have the same work ethic. I want him to, you know, put it all in. I mean, what are we, you know, why else are we here? If you don't just put it all in it, put it all on the table and try to do the best, you know. Uh-oh, sorry.
No problem.
I put Do Not Disturb on. I was trying to figure out why that happened. Yeah. Sorry, I put Do Not Disturb on my phone. I don't know.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah, and, you know, the other thing is, with the line of work that you're in, it also serves as that confirmation to your son that you can achieve anything that you set out to do. Because my family in the general sense were very supportive, but I did have some people who doubted very seriously that I knew what I was doing and even trying to do this as a career. I'm just happy that I'm able to show them that, hey, just like I was able to do this, you can do it too. So I think that it's like, in addition to the legacy, it's like you're showing them, you're proving that, hey, you can accomplish anything you set your mind to. And no matter what the naysayers say and try to throw at you, hey, the truth is the truth. You can do it.
You know? Yeah, you really can. It's really amazing how. I mean, we as witnesses, we can see it every day. We see, like, how did they do that? How did they do that? Well, they did it. They just did it. You know, you just got to keep going. And it's, you know, just got to keep going and be true to yourself and trust that God's timing is perfect time.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. So your song, Soft Words, I had the extreme privilege of listening to that one. And I love it. I love that. I think that it's a very beautiful and very expressive song of love. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering sort of what your focus was when you did that track.
Well, when I first recorded it, my focus was because my friend Dwayne Reed wrote the song for his wife for a birthday present. So it was just supposed to be just like just singing the song, interpreting the song just so he can give it to her. And I just did it, you know, with love in my heart because the words are so beautiful. Like as far as like, you know, just speaking to someone, when you're in a relationship and choosing the right attitude and the right words, even when you're going through stuff, is important because, you know, just lashing out at people or speaking to them harshly is damaging.
Yeah.
And my mom used to teach me, she said, words are very important. What you say to somebody will last forever. Mm-hmm. So be careful of the words you say to people because they will, you know, it doesn't go away. And so I'm, you know, being conscious of that and also understanding that, you know, that's the kind of relationship I want. I want somebody to speak, you know, just even in our arguments, just to know how to speak to each other.
Yeah.
It's very, very important. So I want it to be in a relationship like that. So it kind of touched my heart. So I was excited when he, when I asked, I said, you know, Dwayne, are you okay with me putting this out on my record label? And he was like really excited. And so he's been very supportive through the whole process. And so it was good. It's good. It's good that it's doing so well. I'm really happy.
Yeah. It's a great track. It's a great, wonderful track. I love it.
Thank you.
As I do all your stuff, but one of the latest, you know, hey, I love that one too.
Strength, baby. Strength, salt, what do you do for that? Does it?
So with all the changes and all the things that constantly take place in this industry, you have cases, a lot of cases where things that once served as pretty lucrative sources of income, may not produce as much because of some change or some new technological advance and something like that that may have come along. So it's becoming more evident that it's important to not only have an artistic point of view, but also an entrepreneurial point of view as well in the industry. And I was wondering if you can just, for the benefit of those watching and listening, just give your rendition of why that's so important in this, for artists to do in this industry.
Yeah, well, at this point, because back in the day, the good old days, I call it, which is not really the good old days, but back in the day, the focus on getting a record deal and having a big record company give you this multi-million-dollar deal and all that kind of stuff, and kind of push your career along with the way they see fit, those days are long gone because of the changes in the industry. The technology of the industry has changed. So now people can't get the music anytime. So now it's harder to sell the music. So you won't be very few people can get these big record deals, and very few people understand that the way to make a huge financial change now is to own your own music.
Yep.
And to license it out if you want to, or just have the ownership where you can do what you want with the music, as opposed to somebody else doing what they want with your music and then making all the profit.
Right.
And then trickling down some stuff to you. So now being a record label owner is important to me because I get to leave a legacy again for my son and my future grandchildren, if I have any. Just the notion that I own myself is really cool. I can do whatever I want. So if Lysol comes to me and says, look, we want to use this song, then I get all the profit from it. I have the full control. I can say, Lysol, you can use it. And, the gum company, they can use it, whatever. Gum, let's say, not gun. But anybody could, I can do what I want with the music. And that's really important because that's how these big record companies have generated so much money, because they've been in control.
Off of your hard work.
And then throw money at me like they're doing me a favor. It's just really weird. Like, no, we don't want that anymore. And I know, and it's hard. It's not easy. But the way to get in this is just start, just make up your mind that you're going to do this. Social media is king right now.
Yeah.
I mean, that's how everybody's doing it. Social media, you have to really kind of get a lead on that, a hold on that, so that you can, incorporate this to your new way of life here. Because, like I said, there's not a lot of ways to make it. So now you also have to diversify. So for me, I started to, I created a fragrance line. Well, just two fragrances for men and women, called Unforgettable Man, and the women's is called Back to Love. I based it on my album Back to Love, and that's where I got those songs. That's where the titles of the fragrances came from. And I started selling the fragrances on my website. My website and my Mesa store is called, it's on Mesa.com and also themesastore.com. You can go buy my music there. The previous music I have to buy from a record company. Now this music I have now, I print and make myself, and it's really cool. And I get all the profit from it. So I really suggest, some people don't want to do all that work though, because it's a lot of work. I literally do everything. I even package everything and send it out. Like, I do it all myself.
Wow.
I don't have any other help. I do all my social media. If you're talking to me on social media, you're talking to me. It's not talking to an assistant, talking to anybody else.
Right.
So, I do that, and I have to do all my little commercials. I do whatever advertisements I do, So it's a lot, and it's overwhelming. And then I'm a mom, of course, I'm a mom, so I do that part of my life too. So it's a lot. It's overwhelming. But the rewards, I know that, my faith in God, I know that the rewards are going to be amazing. So I'm sticking to it, and I'm going to stay to it and see what happens.
That's awesome. that's fantastic. doing as much as you can to eliminate the middleman, you know, that and learning as much as you can and how to do it yourself. You know, you maximize your profits, you know, and your overall wealth will grow much faster than having all these other hands involved in your stuff. I mean, and nothing wrong with that per se, but if there's a way that you can do it on your own, you know, then that's money you get to keep, you know?
Yeah.
And so I applaud you for that one. I mean, I applaud you. That's awesome. That's awesome.
Thank you, honey.
So the Mesa's Kitchen Karaoke Sundays, right? So can you tell me a little bit more about how that got started and then?
Wow. This week we are celebrating 5 years of being on Facebook. And yeah, I'm going to do this. I'm pulling together today or tomorrow. I'm going to pull together a little montage of all the karaoke, well, as many as I can, to kind of celebrate the fact that this is 5 years in. I started it. My friend Walter Beasley, saxophone player, told me. He said Mesa years ago. He's been very influential in a lot of stuff. He had me. He influenced me to do my first live album, and then my fragrances, and then, you know, to even get my own label going. And but that day he told me, he said, Mesa, Facebook Live is this new thing and you should take advantage of it and reach out to your, you know, listeners and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And so I said, okay. I was kind of like, you know, you got to put on makeup. You got like, I don't want to go. So I was like, I don't feel like doing that. Then someone told me that to introduce my new website, I should just go live and just say, tell everybody hi. If I sing a song or two and just, you know. And it kind of, it was really great that first night. And people came and said, are you going to do this again next Sunday? And I was like, okay, yeah, I'll come back next Sunday. Yeah. And then it just kind of snowballed where it was just, you know, a few thousand people. Then now we're like, every week we get average between, you know, 25 to 30, 40,000 people a week. Sometimes we've gotten up to 100,000. It's been really cool. And it's a big family. People come on every Sunday, and, you know, and I do my little, we call it like a shout outs, like shout out, call out people's names and stuff and welcome them or welcome them back to karaoke. And, you know, I sing for, you know, it started off me doing 30 minutes and now it's about almost 2 hours.
Oh yeah. Okay.
Hey, yeah.
That's so, what happens when you're having fun. You know, you lose track of time.
Right. It goes by so fast. It really does go by fast. And so, you know, take requests, you know, and all that kind of stuff. And people inbox me the song they want to hear. It's really cool. I love thanking people. This is what it was. It was to thank everybody for my career. And now this year I'm celebrating 30 years in the music industry.
Oh, wow.
And it's been a long time. My gosh. And so with all that, you know, the last year I celebrated my 25th anniversary as a solo artist.
Okay.
So it's been crazy. It's been beautiful and crazy. But that's what Kitchen Karaoke is every Sunday night, 7:30 p.m. Eastern time on Facebook Live.
Wow.
I try to keep it going.
That's wonderful, man. That's wonderful right there. So congratulations on 5 years on your show.
Thank you.
And congratulations on such an illustrious career that you've had 30 years celebrating. That's a blessing. So congratulations on both of those milestones. Those are like, wow, man. Wow. And you know, that's what I love when people who aspire to have a career in the industry, they can refer to like this interview and things like that. And that gives them something to aspire to. You know, what you
accomplished,
this is like, whoa, this is like what do they call it? Like a blue plan, you know?
Okay.
Where they can kind of like, hey, this is what I need to be trying to do, you know? So I thank you very much for that information. And then so also, I think with all that you mentioned that you do as an artist and entrepreneur, I guess, you know, what could get lost in that is that you are as much a devoted humanitarian as you are an artist and entrepreneur. And I was wondering if you could kind of elaborate a little bit on your humanitarian work as well.
Well, years ago, my son was born in Osaka, Japan, while I was on tour with Incognito. He was born 3 months premature. He was born at 25 weeks.
Okay.
And that was very, very premature. So when I was there and going through that whole traumatic and beautiful experience, I was given the number of somebody. I was going through a very traumatic time. So somebody gave me a number to call the March of Dimes.
Okay.
And I looked online and I looked at on the computer and stuff, and people brought me sent me information, talked on the phone about information and how to get information from the March of Dimes to kind of help me go through my period of being a premature mom.
Yeah.
And it was just beautiful. They gave me a lot of resources, a lot of help. Yeah. I spoke to several counselors and they were great. So when it was my chance, I had a chance to, a few years later when Jez was a little older, the first experience I had was that my son, when we got him home finally, because they had to leave him in Japan for 3 months until he gained enough weight to become big enough to get on the airplane. Okay. When he got to be 5 pounds, and we were able to transfer him back home. So as I went to get him and brought him home, but a few months after that, I noticed my son wasn't breathing well, and I thought it was just a cold. But he had a little cold. But then I noticed he wasn't breathing. Rushed him to the hospital, and they gave him a medicine called Synergis. Okay. And this medicine was to help prevent him from getting a disease called RSV, which is respiratory syncytial virus. Okay. And most babies who are born at risk, born prematurely or with heart disease or lung disease or something like that, they are most times hospitalized before they're 2 years old because of that. RSV turns into, it goes from a cold to pneumonia, bronchial problems very quickly in babies. So I know that I was blessed with insurance and that the doctors, they helped me get, because the shots were that he needed were $1,000 a piece at the time. And so I couldn't afford that at that time. And so I was able to get some help. Okay. So the March of Dimes, I was able to work with the March of Dimes and MedImmune pharmaceutical company to reach out, do an outreach to women who had premature babies who had this problem so that we could help them raise money to get funded so that they wouldn't have to worry about that, worrying about money and all that kind of stuff to get this medicine for their babies. So then fast forward to a couple of years ago, my manager, I was telling him that I wanted to do something with the March of Dimes again, because I really enjoyed working with them.
Yeah.
And that's when I wrote the song, You Are Not Alone, that's UPS.
Oh, no.
I wrote the song, You Are Not Alone, to talk more about this and talk about premature babies and have how devastating it is to families to have a baby born too soon. So the preemie thing is a big thing to me, and I hope to do a lot more with that.
Yeah.
I'm blessed. Our experience was just so, so blessed. My son is strong. He's strong and healthy and 21 years old, about to graduate college. Awesome. And so, you know, he's done great things. And so, you know, to be born so early at 2 pounds, and then now he's skinny but strong, young man, you know, it's a beautiful thing. So I want to help other moms, you know, go through that too. So that's what I love to do. And of course, I just, you know, that's my biggest focus as far as the humanitarian thing going.
Well, that's a beautiful thing. I thank you for sharing that. You know, that one of the biggest obstacles, probably the single biggest obstacle that parents face when they have a crisis like that is financial. And for you to do that and help shed light on options that they have and programs that can help, you know, kind of take a lot of that burden away, where they can kind of just put their focus on caring for the child and helping them get stronger and recover from, you know, my son was, I can't remember how many weeks premature he was, but he spent about, 3.5 weeks in the
NICU.
He spent some time there, and my wife, she had to spend some extended time in the hospital because of, you know, some of the physical impacts it had on her. So, you know, to see other people who have had their own ordeal and how they handle it, you know, it just helps you sort of have a more appreciation for life, you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
And that you're not the only one who has gone through something, you know, and there is support out there for whatever it is you may need. You just have to look, you know, and you shed light on that. And otherwise that might've been more difficult for people to kind of find that resource. You know?
Right.
So I applaud you for that as well. So
thank you, honey. Thank you. I appreciate it.
No problem at all. So are there any new projects, any new things that you're working on in the future?
I think mostly just raising money for the label and also to do my 14th solo album. I'm still working on that. I just released the first four singles that I put out on my record company, You Are Not Alone. It's Going to Be All Right, featuring Phil Perry and Chris Big Dog Davis and Kim Waters. And then Loving You Is Easy and now Soft Words. So I did a campaign where I did my first printing for my label. And I did a big campaign on Facebook and it turned out really well. The first 100, well now it's about 120, the first 120 people so far to buy them. They will be the first people ever to buy my first first singles. And so that's a little EP I put out. But now I have to change the focus to really getting my album. It's called Music For Your Soul. And so I'm really getting into how I wanted to sound, how I wanted to feel. And then, of course, raising the money to make it happen. Because I want to do a whole campaign. I want to hire a publicist. I want to do videos. Yeah. So it's going to take a little bit of time to raise that money. But I'm working on it.
Hey, slow and steady. You know, that wins the race, you know.
Yeah, absolutely.
What's the name of your record label?
Blue Velvet Soul Records.
Oh, okay. All right. Okay. Uh-huh. All right. So, hey, everybody, hey, if you didn't know, that's the name of it. I appreciate you very deeply. I think that it's clear, right, that you have a deep passion for what you do. And that's something that has served you well throughout your career. And it's just something that people need to see. So that they understand that, you know, passion pays off. You know, when you really have a passion for what you do and you love what you do, you're going to automatically do the things that you mentioned, like put the 150% into your project and all the things that you're going to do to bring everybody the best version of you that you can, because you have a love and a passion for what you do. And that's very important for any, whether you're trying to be in the entertainment industry or whatever industry you're getting into, medical field, what have you, passion pays off. You know, if you don't really have passion for it, if what you're doing, despite the amount of money it makes, right, if it's not connecting with your passion, you're probably not going to stick with it very long.
Right, or be happy and, you know, suffer.
Exactly, you won't be happy. Yeah, you it'll be like almost like a prison camp or something. But you know. But it's your passion pays off in a lot of ways, not just financially, but also fulfillment-wise, success. You know, and as you mentioned, leaving a legacy behind for your family and for them to, they'll be able to look back on it and admire it and like, wow, and look what she did. Look what she did set up for us. Yeah. You know? And that puts pressure on them and responsibility on them to keep that up because we have to maintain what she did, you know? So I appreciate you for coming onto the show and sharing all of yourself with me and those who will be tuning in very much. I appreciate that.
Thank you, LaVelle. I appreciate you having me, honey.
No problem. Really my pleasure. Absolute pleasure. So you enjoy the rest of your day. God bless you and your family.
Thank you, honey.
And I just wish you continued success for here on out.
Thank you, babe. Thank you so much, honey.
I must love to you and yours, and you have a blessed day now.
Same to you. Thank you so much.
All right. Bye. Of your time.
force of gravity. You're making me high. Cast a spell on me when I looked into your eyes. I'm wanting you more and more. Baby, you make my heart soar.
Make my heart soar.
Make my heart soar. Ooh, yeah.
Closer and closer.
How about that? What a great interview. A great interview with a great person. MAYSA, you're a wonderful person. I thank you very much for taking time out to talk to me on the Keynote Cafe. MAYSA went over some very important details about her career, and milestones of her career. You know, she talked about her many things about her award-winning career, as well as her show. That comes on at 7:30 on Sundays, called MAYSA's Kitchen Karaoke Sundays. Make sure you catch that every Sunday at 7:30 Eastern. Very great show, a very popular show. She's celebrating, I think, 5 years now with that show. Very successful, and it's continuing to gain success. And as you heard, she's celebrating 30 years in the industry. Wow. What a great accomplishment. What a great story of an example of longevity, you know, and sticking to what you love and doing it and just doing it until you can't do it no more, you know. And she's just getting started, okay? So how about that one? She's just getting started. MAYSA is a great inspiration for many up and coming artists, as well as those who are established already and doing their thing. she serves as a great example of inspiration and success that everyone can achieve. You know, she has her own fragrance line, you know, and she has several things. You know, she has that type of entrepreneurial spirit that we all need to have in this industry in order to continue to have success. You have to think outside the box. You can't just stay focused on one thing. You have to diversify. You got to do many things. And she exemplifies that with her career and the choices that she's made, you know, and those things that she had to do when faced with the impacts of the COVID-19 pandemic. You know, she just maneuvered and did things to stay relevant. And as you can see, she's just getting started. She's still gaining even more success, as successful as she is. So, hey, thank you, Maysa. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in. And look forward to seeing you next time on the Keynote Cafe when we talk to our next guest. All right. Have a good day.